Let's talk about Overwatch. Season 3, I've been having problems getting out of gold and into platinum. Trying to find a solution seemed impossible. I've been playing with 6 people or just 2 to 3 people that I know. Nothing seems to stick, no magical fix. I've been working on my game as soldier, trying to improve my aim, getting those headshots. That doesn't seem to work. Trying to carry or get carried out of gold seemed impossible, so I resorted to searching the web for answers, and I came across a video by a channel called Your Overwatch. And the video is entitled, Overwatch, I've Got Gold Medals Fallacy. Quite a few people didn't like this video. Hey, don't get me wrong, Blizzard is good at making games, but when it comes to playing their own game, I think they tend to miss the point or just entirely misunderstand the core concepts that they install themselves. There's a running joke amongst the people I play with at Blizzard. Doesn't know how to play their own game. Especially with the rise of triple tank, the game likes to condescendingly remark that you don't have enough damage and too many tanks, even when that's been what's been winning. Then comes down to the problem of the medal system. Considering the majority of the players in the match won't get 3 out of the 5 medals, what, I mean, what's the point? I mean, is your Zen going to outdamage your Reaper? If Zen does, I would question the Reaper pick. So what's the point of medals? Your other 1 DPS to lord over the other DPS on your team? Because your supports aren't going to get it, and chances are your tanks aren't going to get them either. Should Zarya be getting the most eliminations on your team? If she is, then what is your DPS doing? You know, what is your Reaper doing? What is your Soldier doing? What is your Pharah doing? What is your Tracer doing? But my point comes down to 2 out of the 5 medals you can potentially get. Damage and eliminations. I mean, objective kills really doesn't matter too much. If you win the team fight, it doesn't matter if they died on the objective, in my opinion. But for eliminations and damage, I mean, really, those are kind of the hallmarks of DPS characters, damage characters, offense characters, characters that are built with the idea of doing damage, that have the kit to do damage. I mean, you're a very small subset of all the characters would have the potential in a normal match to get these medals. So why do I have a Junkrat on my team saying he's got gold damage and using that as a defense to not switch when we're still losing? I mean, come on, Blizzard. You know, throw me a bone here.
Good job. Got her.
You're just, you enable, I guess, bad play. I mean, I understand the idea of this. I mean, we went through the same problem when TF2 took the, I believe it was TF2 that first did this, that they took the kill-death ratio off the scoreboard. Valve wanted to force good play, good team play. So, I mean, why would you need someone who's at the top of the kill board, but you need someone to play the objective? So you take away the kill-death ratio, so you don't have a guy with 50 to 50 kills and 1 death, you know, holding that over the rest of the team, saying, look how good I'm doing. But then you replace it with a score system, you know, kills are worth a certain score, capturing objectives are worth another score. But really the only way you can, you know, judge yourself as a offense character is if you have gold eliminations and gold damage. And if I'm playing soldier and I have gold eliminations and gold damage, I don't care. I mean, that just says I'm, you know, performing my role as soldier. I'm shooting the dudes, killing the dudes. You know, so what? And if I don't have gold damage and gold eliminations as soldier, maybe I'm not doing so hot, but I also have to look around at the rest of my team and kind of go by a feel about how difficult of a time we're having achieving our objective, pushing the cart, capturing the control point. I mean, obviously, if we're capturing the control point, but yet the enemy team is giving us an extremely hard time, maybe it's then we need to start to think about, you know, swapping something out, changing up our play style, grouping up a little bit better. But just the metal system itself, I feel, harkens back to the old idea, the whole controversy of the kill-death ratio that's been around for a very long time ago, except it's just been rebranded. It hasn't been solved by this metal system. You've just rebranded the old kill-death ratio. It's like being at the podium at the Olympics. Yeah, I got gold. I'm at the top. I'm the best. Well, that's great. You know, it was a relay race. You know, it was a team effort. There is no sure, you may have ran the fastest in the relay, but, you know, we still lost. They say the chain is only strong as its weakest link, but, you know, in Overwatch, with it being a team game like it is, you know, how do you identify at gold levels or silver or bronze or platinum, how do you truly identify a poor performer on your team? I mean, how do you do that? How do you judge efficiency on your team when you got the stupid gold medal system?
Wow.
You got the stupid medal system that Blizzard has shackled us with. Especially in public games. You know, you get six pubbies, you know. Five pubbies. You and five pubbies. You're going to have, obviously, you're going to have confirmation bias in there. I mean, you're the hero of your story. I mean, you, of course, are going to be doing the best, because everybody wants to be the hero. Everybody wants to be the best. And nobody wants to admit that they've messed up or they've made a wrong choice. And how do you see your own mistakes in a high-pressure game? Time is ticking down. You got a lot of stuff going around. Maybe you got people getting a little short with you on your team, screaming in the mic. You just want to mute them. So how do you take yourself out of that? How do you objectify your performance? How do you objectify your team's performance? And the one thing I've discovered, or at least I should have been doing more often, is watching my own games. Downloading Bandicam, Shadowplay, OBS, and just hitting record. It doesn't have to be a good quality. I mean, you play the game, it's still fresh in your memory. And you could just watch it after you've played it, after you have all the adrenaline leaves your system, after, you know, all the headaches leave, you get this kind of detached, you know, observation from it. You're not pressing the keys, you're not using your mouse, you know, you don't have the pressure of performance being held over you. You can see all the actions you took. You can see all the actions your teammates took. And, you know, that helps me understand, you know, what I need to do in the game to help myself and help my team, regardless of the medal system, what the medal system tells me, I'm performing. Because it doesn't matter. The medals just don't matter to me. I mean, I could get bronze medals left, right, and center. I mean, I don't care. I mean, if we're winning the objective and we're not working really, really hard to capture that objective, to push that cart, then everything's working. Then why do we need to make a change? But if we're barely making it, and I got gold, what's going on?
All right, do you guys want me to be support still?
I mean, I'm doing a lot of killing, I'm doing a lot of damage, but the team's just not synergizing with what I'm doing. But even watching this game, I can identify points where I can improve. Obviously, when I was playing Zenyatta, there was huge improvements I can do to my aim. I mean, I constantly have problems adjusting to his projectile speed and learning how to lead and hitting my targets properly. And I always have a desire to be at the front of the fight, be up close, get my enemy's face, blast them, you know, just be super aggressive. But that's not the kind of playstyle that a support should be using. It's one of the reasons why I don't like playing supports, because you gotta be more squirrely, you gotta be more passive, you gotta let your teammates be at the head of the game, let them get the glory while you sit back and you assist. I just don't like doing that. I don't like assisting. I like doing. I don't like watching. I don't like watching someone else have all the fun. I want to be doing it. I want to be killing the dudes. I want to be shooting the dudes. I want to be getting the play of the game. I want to be that guy on the podium getting the gold
usually
medals.
The gas station is the best place.
It's
to
just
hold up.
It's ingrained into me. It's like 60 feet a dog. It's like walking past a fence and having that dog chase you up and down the fence while you're walking past. It's just, I get that desire to just do that. I want to sink my teeth into it, but I know I got to hold myself back in order to and better my team. And I think I can kind of see, you know, certain parts of brilliance in my own play here, you know, where I'm letting our tanks do their work, and I'm trying to just kind of stay back and do my thing. And there's a couple times where, you know, I get into trouble, you know, poke out a little too far, I I tried dueling a soldier at one point in the gas station and as Zenyatta, and just whiff all my shots. You know, if I was a little better at Zenyatta, I probably would have taken him, is what I think. And there was also a couple times where I feel like I popped my ult maybe a little too soon, or I didn't wait for the right moment to use my ultimate as Zenyatta. But I think the idea behind me using my ultimate in those situations was I wanted to either maintain momentum or I wanted to preserve what we've gained. Kind of like trying to pressure the enemy into doing something that they didn't want to do. But honestly, I can definitely need a lot more game sense before my Zenyatta play gets a lot better. And then, of course, you have the D.Va, you know, when I was playing D.Va on the second round. I don't know why I switched off of Zenyatta, because I was getting kind of impatient playing. I mean, you know, that was one of the things where you see, I really don't want to play the support. I want to play the tank. I want to play the offense characters. So I tend to feel like I get typecasted as a support or a tank. I really don't like that. I like playing soldier.
Behind,
or,
above.
You know, I like playing those kind of characters. So even in my D.Va play style, you know, I'm not really being a support. I'm not supporting my team. I'm not playing as a tank should. I'm using defense matrix fairly selfishly. I'm using my positioning fairly selfishly. I'm not using it to exploit an opening in the enemy team. I'm using it to move myself around in order to get frags. And honestly, that's kind of a bad habit. You know, probably should learn to control myself a little more. Sit back and use defense matrix to kind of shield our DPS and, you know, kind of act as an enforcer for our own offense character so they can kind of shine. But, you know, that's one of those things where you got to learn restraint. And I guess maybe I'm not quite ready for that yet. But you learn this stuff just, you know, sitting back and objectively watching the game after it's over. You don't have to record in 1080p, 60 frames per second. You know, you don't have to record in 720p. I mean, you were there. It was your game. You know, I'm watching in the editing software right now. I'm just watching the game tick by. And it's really crappy preview. And that's good enough for me. I'm like, oh, I know what that character is. I mean, Blizzard honestly did a good job with the silhouettes of these characters. Even with really crappy resolution, you can kind of tell which character you're looking at. You can tell a Reinhardt from a Roadhog. You can tell a soldier from an Ana.
So far, I have.
So, I mean, it works out. I mean, the only really excuse I can think of for not recording your own games and watching them is hardware performance isn't up to spec. Honestly, with Shadowplay though, I mean, there's really not an excuse. I mean, some of these recording softwares are so lightweight and so non-intrusive to frame rate that there's really no excuse to use them. But, you know, I actually had some problems with Shadowplay, so I had to switch over to OBS. But that's, you know, that's kind of like how it is. You know, not everybody's going to have a great time. Not everyone's going to have a problem-free experience. So I planned maybe later on doing a tutorial video for OBS, at least for my settings, just so we can get that stuff out there so people can kind of see how easy it is to get this stuff up and running and how to use it to their own benefit. I think I'm getting to the point where I'm starting to ramble now. I'm just going to let this video play out. But thanks for watching. I do appreciate it.
To be fair, they are doing a lot worse than us.
Yeah, I know, but we can definitely hold it at this point.
We should be able to.
Yeah, right. They only have a minute and 15 seconds. We're good.
All right, Reinhardt, I'm with you.
Yep.
Roadhog's going to the building.
wasted his ult. Shit, shit, shit. I'm still alive. I must have ult 90%.
Oh no, not another hammer down.
We got this. We got it. Great game. Fucking fantastic job, guys.
Yeah, that was pretty good. Finals.